Čast mi je i zadovoljstvo pozdraviti vas na drugom trijenalu znanstvenog skupa Grad hrvatskog srednjovjekovlja. Želim zahvaliti svim izlagačima na odazivu i domaćim i inozemnim, kao i svim zainteresiranima koji će pratiti izlaganja skupa. Drago mi je da je skup zaživio kao tradicionalno okupljanje stručnjaka koji se unutar raznih disciplina bavi istraživanjem srednjovjekovnog grada. Zahvaljujem ravnateljici doktorici Jasni Turkalj na podršci te ideje, kao i na tome što je podržala da se zbornik prošloga skupa objavi na engleskom jeziku kako bi naše istraživanja postala međunarodno vidljivija. Kao što je već rečeno, ovom smo prilikom kao podnaslov skupa odabrali temu slika grada u narativnim vrelima, stvarnost i ili fikcija. Na pomoći u osmišljavanju teme zahvaljujem i članovima znanstvenog odbora ovoga skupa, dakle doktorici Zrinki Pešo Davardić, akademiku Nenadu Vekariću, doktoru Danku Zeliću i doktoru Stanku Andriću. Nadalje, zahvaljujem i moderatorima sekcija koji su se ljubazno odazvali našemu pozivu, doktorici Zrinki Nikolić-Jakus, doktorici Mariji Karbić, doktoru Stanku Andriću, doktoru Danku Zeliću i doktoru Trpimiru Vedrišu. Također hvala i našoj novakinji Sandri Begonji na velikoj pomoći u pripremi materijala za skup. Izvori za istraživanje slike srednjovjekovnog grada, njegova izgleda, društvenih struktura, gradskih institucija i pojava mogu biti različitog karaktera. Pisani izvori različite provenijencije, slikovni ili materijalni, suvremeni, odnosno izvori iz kasnih razdoblja. Narativna vrela srednjeg i ranog novog vijeka predstavljaju važan pisani izvor za istraživanje srednjovjekovnog urbaniteta. Njihova autentičnost i pouzdanost puno je puta dovedena u pitanje, te još uvijek postoje brojne kontroverze u pristupu istraživanju, što se pokazalo i na nedavno održanim hrvatskim skupovima o često korištenim srednjovjekovnim narativnim vrelima. I međunarodno, tema o ovoj vrsti vrela pobuđuje sve veću pažnju. Ipak, ona su manje bila središte interesa kao izvor za istraživanje slike srednjovjekovnog grada. Velik broj narativnih vrela različitih žanrova producirani na hrvatskim prostorima u rečenom razdoblju, a u njima se više ili manje ocrtava slika srednjovjekovnog grada. Razina i prostor njihove sačuvanosti su različiti od fragmenata do cjelovitih dijela. U nekim dalmatinskim središtima se čuva izrazito bogat opus, dok je primjerice neusporedivo manji poznatih i ili sačuvanih s područja Slavonije. Dakako, sačuvan je i niz stranih narativnih izvora koji su tek djelomično poznati i korišteni u istraživanju hrvatskog srednjovjekovlja. Slika grada u narativnim vrelima različita je s obzirom na vrijeme i prostor pisanja, karakter i porijeklo izvora. U najranijim pripovjednim izvorima, primjerice svetačkim legendama i životopisima, dominiraju vijesti o raznim osobama, kultovima ili crkvenim institucijama, a sporadični podaci o pojedinom gradu su usputni i idealni. Načini komuniciranja s potencijalnom publikom poslije su različiti nego u kasnijem razdoblju. Neki poznati strani narativni spisi ranog srednjeg vijeka donose opise gradova hrvatskog srednjovjekovlja, a slika grada u njima rezultati različitih kanala, diplomacije, pisanih vrela. Bez obzira na detalje o etimologiji grada, građevinama i nekim zanimljivostima, slika grada u njima je ograničena, a oni su uklopljeni u širu sliku s političkom svrhom. U najranijim putopisima, koji se u srednjem vijeku uglavnom svode na hodočasničke tekstove, tek se unutar opisa onostranoga može pronaći i kratki opis ovostranoga mjesta. Slika grada u narativnim izvorima postaje vidljivija od 12. i 13. stoljeća kada dolazi do nagle urbanizacije u Europi. Ali znatnog razvoja pismenosti, sustavnije vođenje gradskih administracija rezultiralo je velikim brojem bilježničkih dokumenata kao i onih fiskalnog i normativnog karaktera. Njihovo se prisustvo osjećaju narativnim vrelima toga razdoblja. Osim privatnih i javnih isprava, u gradskim sredinama, unutar određenog kruga korisnika, cirkulirali su i stariji narativni tekstualni predlošci, koji su svojom formom, motivima i odabirom tema utjecali i na nove zapise u gradu. U razvijenom srednjem vijeku, u raznim ljetopisima, kronikama, memoarima ili povjesnicama, a često se ne radi o čistim žanrovima, možemo naći sve više podataka o slici grada. Pripovijesti o događajima dalje su vezane uz teologiju, filozofiju, druga znanja, a često se jednako vrijedno tretiraju podaci vrlo različite provenijencije i vjerodostojnosti. U nekim su dijelima toga razdoblja opširno opisani razni povijesni i suvremeni događaji, pojave ili geografske sastavnice, a slika konkretnih gradova unutar njihova prostornog okvira ostala je više ili manje ograničena. U drugima su suvremenici detaljnije opisivali događaje iz kraćeg razdoblja povijesti grada. Izbor tema u njima je ipak selektivan, pragmatičnog karaktera, jer je njihova proizvodnja bila vezana uz sustave koji su određivali što treba zapamtiti, a što zaboraviti. Veća fokusiranost na grad kao motiv i predmet pisanja od 13. stoljeća može se pratiti i u žanrovskom okolišu tzv. Laudationes Urbium, osobito gradovima s antičkom i ranosrednjovjekovnom tradicijom. Pohvale gradova sastoje se od različitih pjesničkih, ali i proznih dijela u kojima se hvale ili kritiziraju gradovi. Taj urbani encomium pojavljuje se ne slučajno u razdoblju kada gradovi postaju ključni za opći društveni razvoj i gospodarstvo. Privilegirani statusi, autonoman položaj, ali i rivalitet prema drugim gradovima legitimirali su traganje za vlastitim urbanim identitetom te subjektivno zapisivanje slavnoga porijekla. Pod utjecajem humanizma i renesanse, grad se još više počinje shvaćati kao mikrokozmos kroz čiju se prošlost davala politička ili moralna poruka. Pismena komunikacija postaje sve kompleksnija, osobito pojavom tiskane knjige, a u trendu je bilo i korištenje antičkih izvora, dostupnih humanističkih rječnika i kompendija. Ideja o uređenom gradu, kao i državi, odražava se i u narativnim dijelima ne samo povijesnog, nego i teorijskog i filozofskog karaktera. Ističe se koncept idealnog grada i sretne zajednice građana, takako na čelu s mudrom upravom potpomognutom milošću gradskog patrone. Dakle, zajednice kakva bi trebala biti, a ne kakva nužno jest. Slika grada u pojedinim traktatima unutar raznih tema i uputa kreće se između ideala i želja te stvarnog lokalnog iskustva. Uz hodočasničke u ovom se razdoblju javlja sve veći procvat i putopisa drukčijeg karaktera, razni funkcionalni putni zapisi svjetovnih ili crkvenih osoba. U njima je grad najčešće doživljen izvana, iz sužene perspektive ili čak izvan lokalne stvarnosti. Od kasnog srednjeg vijeka, a osobito u ranom srednjem novom vijeku, dolazi do pojave raznih, uvjetno rečeno, urbanih biografija, koji su čuvale memoriju grada sa ciljem da predaju, ali i objasne znanja o gradu suvremenicima, a potom i budućim generacijama. Najvažnije događaje u povijesti grada od najstarijih vremena do trenutka zapisivanja naći ćemo sažeto obličene u gradskim analima i kronikama grada. Prvima koji kronološko bilježe listu značajnih događaja, te drugima koji slične podatke dopunjuju opširnim pripovjednim objašnjenjima. Najčešće se ni ovdje ne radi o jasno definiranom žanru, već o raznim varijantama, kompilacijama čiji su sastavljači prepisivali dostupna narativna vrela, popunjavali ih prema potrebama itd. Također usporedimo li različite urbane biografije jednog grada, vidjet ćemo mnoge nesustavnosti, proturječnosti, kronologije, bez obzira na neka očito zajednička ishodišta. Te takozvane urbane biografije ne samo da su bile fokusirane na povijesno iskustvo jednog grada, već je to bio i jedan od njihovih ciljeva. Dio tema koje bilježe su opća mjesta, preuzeta i iz starijih tekstualnih predložaka i nadopunjena prema potrebi, kao ono o porijeklu grada, njegovoj lokaciji, u patronu koji je osiguravao sigurnost, postignućima građana, neprijateljima i ratovima, važnim građevinama. Prostor gradova ovim dijelima neizmjerno je važniji od prostora koji ih je okruživao, a ponekad je zapisan na način da je mogao funkcionirati i u vremenu autorova pisanja, ali i u prošlosti. Osnutak i porijeklo grada i dalje se vežu uz imaginarno. Mitovi i legende ne prestaju ni u razdoblju predkritičke historiografije, već često dobivaju novu dimenziju, prilagođenu novome vremenu. Zadržavanje takvih tradicija služilo je u političke svrhe, jer se njima podupirala priča o dobrome porijeklu grada i njegovih građana. Ono je također moglo biti rezultat želje da se taj kulturni kapital prenese zajednici obrazovanih. Antička je prošlost grada ipak bila usklađena s kršćanskim poimanjem. Ovisno o društvenim okolnostima, u konstrukciji zapisa o Rigi Urbis korišteni su često i neantički mitovi. U istraživanju slike grada u narativnim vrelima važno je da kako poznavanje lokalne sredine te političkih, društvenih i kulturnih prilika u razdoblju u kojem je narativno djelo pisano. Narativna djela sastavljana su od strane crkvenih, a od razvijenog srednjeg vijeka sve više svjetovnih osoba, od domaćih autora ili pak od stranaca koji su živjeli privremeno ili stalno u gradskim sredinama ili pak posve izvan njih. Svakako je percepcija o lokalnom značenju pojedinog grada ovisila i o tome. Valja poznavati strukturu fonda, izvora koji su bili čuvani u gradovima, iako oni nisu svima bili jednako dostupni zbog ograničenosti širenja informacija, nesustavnosti čuvanja podataka, tajnosti podataka i nedostatka pismenosti. U narativnim vrelima sačuvana i usmena urbana memorija prošlih generacija kao i opće društveno znanje lokalne sredine. Osim iščitavanja tradicije, nasljeđa ili utjecaja nekog izvora u narativnom vrelu, važno je razumijevanje recepcije tih izvora u datom vremenu i prostoru, koji su bili postupci izbora i ponovne upotrebe dostupne građe i kako značenje ona ima u suvremenom kontekstu. Narativna vrela na neki su način odraz dugoročnog kolektivnog stvaralaštva gradske zajednice, ne samo individualna tvorevina. Konačno u nekim narativnim vrelima prepoznaju se i ruke više sastavljača, a neki su naslovi sačuvani u različitim lokalnim prilikama prilagođenim redakcijama. Podaci iz narativnih vrela u kontekstu istraživanja srednjovjekovnog urbaniteta u Hrvatskoj su u historiografiji različito korišteni. Neki vrlo studiozno, drugi tek djelomično ili selektivno, a neki čak i nedovoljno kritički. Pristup se kreće u širokom rasponu između potpunog odbacivanja do apsolutnog prihvaćanja, ali konačno nisu ni sva narativna vrela jednakoj vjerodostojnosti. Kada u drugim vrstama izvora nedostaje podataka, a što je osobito slučaj u razdoblju ranog srednjeg vijeka, narativni izvori mogu se činiti vrlo privlačnima jer pružaju bar neku sliku koja se uz kritičku metodu, skidanjem slojeva legendi, izmišljotina i dodataka možda mogu naći zrnca povijesne istine. Rekonstrukcija slike grada na temelju narativnih vrela tako postaje moderni narativ koji popunjava taj neizbježan horor vakui i osigurava potreban kontinuitet događaja i procesa. Tako neka narativna djela ili neki njihovi podaci mogu dobiti na većoj vrijednosti ili autentičnosti nego zaslužuju. Kombiniranje podataka iz narativnih izvora ipak ne može koristiti kao čvrsto polazište za rekonstrukciju slike grada prema potrebi. Činjenica je da mnogi ranosrednjovjekovni izvori do nas dolaze u kasnim prijepisima, pa se ne možemo uvijek osloniti na palografske analize, a ni one jezične ne mogu lako doći do izvornih oblika pripovijesti. Kasni su pisci često starije predloške preobražavali u tvorbe u kojima su izvorni detalji posve izgubljeni. Termini korišteni u opisu ranijeg razdoblja često su iz pišćeva vremena, tako da se realnost suvremenog konteksta projicira u starije situacije. Neki su pak pojmovi preuzeti iz općih riječnika i priručnika, te nema nikakve veze s lokalnom gradskom tradicijom. Narativna vrela, dakle, i sama su povijesna činjenica. Historiografska predodžba grada u njima stvara se u relaciji s kontekstom njihova vremena, te namjerama njihova pisanja. Ono što se nama čini važnim, sasvim je različito od onoga što je bilo važno piscima narativnih djela. Pojmovi od kojih mi polazimo, za njih imaju ponekad drukčija značenja. Ta su djela stvarana mentalnim oruđem i u svrhu interesa koji nama nisu uvijek posve razumljivi. Do koje onda razine možemo njima tražiti odgovore na istraživačka pitanja? To nas vraća na samu temu ovoga skupa. Predstavljaju li narativna vrela srednjega i ranog novog vijeka fikciju ili se u njima ipak kriju i određena realija za kojima tragamo u nedostatku drugih vrela? Ako one i postoje, imamo li mi instrumente za njihovo otkrivanje, odnosno odvajanje od različitih narativnih diskursa od kojih se sastoje? Koji su to načini procjenjivanja i kojim mehanizmima dekonstruirati narativna vrela? Unatoč svim ograničenjima i suženoj perspektivi, prema mnogima je vrijednost narativnih vrela za istraživanje srednjovjekovlja neupitna. Jer kao što je već rečeno, često su to jedini izvori u nekim razdobljima i događajima iz gradske prošlosti. Podaci iz narativnih vrela mogu se usporediti s poznatim povijesnim događajima, odnosno drugim vrstama izvorima, osobito za razdoblja nakon razvoja pismenosti. Osim egzaktnih podataka, u narativnim vrelima mogu se prepoznati određeni uzročno-posljedični procesi povećanja grada, planiranja gradskog prostora i tako dalje, koji su bili odraz kolektivne memorije prošlih generacija. Čak i u vrelima ranog srednjeg vijeka, u kojima nećemo naći čiste povijesne činjenice, na temelju nekih narativnih elemenata i motiva može se prepoznati identitet gradskih zajednica. Čini se da bez obzira na njihov karakter, narativna vrela često ostaju voditelji logike rekonstruiranja povijesti. Mnoga istraživanja pokazuju da su neki podaci sačuvani u narativnim vrelima uvelike doprinijeli boljem poznavanju slike srednjevjekovnog grada. Ali ako narativne vrela i nisu uvijek rudnik više ili manje pouzdanih podataka u srednjevjekovnom gradu, oni su svakako prvorazredan izvor koji nam otkriva kontekst Bišćeva vremena. Stanje istraženosti narativnih vrela je različito. Neka su analizirana vrlo detaljno kao žanr ili je istraženo autorstvo, kontekst pisanja, analizirani su i pojedini elementi zapisa, ali slika grada čini se bila manje u fokusu istraživanja. Narativnim su se izvorima bavili povjesničari, klasični filolozi, povjesničari umjetnosti, povjesničari književnosti, arheolozi, a pristup istraživanju ovisi naravno o disciplini. Jedni su pratili nastanak narativnog zapisa i kontekst pisanja, neki tražili povijesnu jezgru priče, neki koristili narativne izvore te kao dodatni komparativni materijal u istraživanju temeljenom na izvorima prve vrste, pisanim ili materijalnim. Ipak čini se da je nedovoljno interdisciplinarnog pristupa tako važnog za istraživanje srednjovjekovne urbane povijesti. Za komparativne analize vrlo je važna dostupnost izvora, tiskana ili digitalizirana. Stoga treba pohvaliti sve istraživače koji su svojim priređivanjima, transkripcijama ili digitaliziranim zbirkama u posljednje vrijeme pridonijeli dostupnosti i pristupu istraživanja ovih vrela. Ovom prilikom ih neću poimence spominjati. Ali svi znamo da velik broj rukopisa još leži u arhivima, domaćim i inozemnim, gotovo netaknut i neiskorišten, a ponekad čak i nedostupan. Ovaj skup želi otvoriti znanstvenu diskusiju o narativnim vrelima srednjega i ranog novog vijeka kao izvorima za istraživanje slike gradova, prvenstveno hrvatskog srednjovjekovlja, ali i šire. S obzirom na dosadašnji rad i teme istraživanja izlagača, nadamo se da će iduća dva dana doprinijeti plodnoj diskusiji i odgovorima na definirana pitanja. Kakva je bila slika grada u pojedinim vrstama narativnih vrela s obzirom na njihov karakter, razdoblje i porijeklo? Kako je konstruirana urbana memorija nekoga grada kroz ta vrela? Je li moguća rekonstrukcija srednjovjekovnog urbaniteta na temelju tih izvora? Kakva je razina istraživanja pojedinih srednjovjekovnih gradova na temelju narativnih vrela? I u konačnici, do koje razine predodžba grada u narativnim vrelima odgovara stvarnosti? Prije nego što riječ prepustim s organizatorici skupa doktorici Zrinki Pešarda Vardić, koja je ujedno i moderatorica prve sekcije, nekoliko tehničkih sitnica, podsjećam sudionike da izlaganja traju 15 minuta, te da je ručak za izlagače u 13 sati u Hege Dušićevoj dvorani instituta. Hvala lijepo.
Dobar dan svima i drago mi je doista čast da evo otvaram ovu prvu radnu sekciju. Dobro, znači drago mi je doista da evo otvaramo znači, prvu sekciju ovog našeg drugog trijenala. I prva sekcija je zamišljena, vidite iz popisa izlagača, svojevrsna znači uvodna sekcija gdje bismo pokušali dobiti možda malo i nekakav komparativni uvid u zapravo u središnju temu ovogodišnjeg, znači trijenala, tako da u njoj imamo i dvoje inozemnih gostiju i osobito mi je čast što ih mogu danas tu pozdraviti. So I would like to welcome our international guests here and I hope you will have a fruitful and enjoyful conference here in Zagreb. Predstavit ćemo ih na hrvatskom dakako. Znači, naša prva današnja gošća je doktorica Ruti Gertwagen. Dolazi sa Haifa sveučilišta i Oranim Academic College-a, Haifa znači iz Izraela je gošća, dolazi nam sa Byzantine and Hellenic Studies School of History. Doktorica Gertwagen ima svoje znači znanstvene interese, prije svega znači bavi se poviješću Bizanta, Venecije i Dženove, i to srednjovjekovnom i rano modernom znači poviješću Venecija, maritimnom poviješću, znači arheologijom vezanom također za tu maritimnu povijest, znači pomorstvo, brodarstvo, poviješću luka, lučkih gradova, pomorskog ratovanja, i znači u tom okviru također i ekohistorijom. Ona je također i član znači International Maritime Economic History Association, i to u više navrate obavljala više raznih funkcija tamo, i također je znači članica uredništva International Journal of Maritime History. I danas, da ne duljim znači više, održat će izlaganje pod naslovom Venice Chronicles and Archaeology, the Methodological Approach. Dakle, govorit će nam znači o Veneciji i kronikama i arheologiji, odnosno o jednom metodološkom pristupu toj temi. So, please take the word.
Good morning. Thank you very much for the invitation. I would like to thank Irena for the invitation. And I'm glad to see the beautiful city of Zagreb. And I hope to understand a lot of the papers, which are very important, but I have my own limitations of language, unfortunately. I would like to deal generally with the methodological approach and to for the study of ports and port towns in the Mediterranean, focusing especially in this case on a Venetian. Although I have worked on from a Byzantine period onwards also in the Levant and in the Western Mediterranean. So the aim of the paper is to highlight the importance of the interdisciplinary approach in the study of art and architecture, including urban architecture, of historic monuments and sites during historic periods, in our case the medieval and early modern periods, regarding, in my case, Mediterranean port towns and port. The following might be, no, I don't have this slide. Sorry. Well, I'm not very good at this. Okay. Where do I push?
Left and right.
Okay. 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 The following might be sounds obvious, however, based on my experience as an historian, especially marine historian, as well as marine and underwater archaeologist, I find the methodology taken too much for granted, and consequently misused starting with misunderstanding of basic terminology. So what do I mean, terminology? No. Wait, I'm not good. Okay, I have to do two things. It's too much for me. Okay, multidisciplinary. I mean to use various disciplines, while each of them sees the other as only illustrative and support of his the main one field. On the other hand, interdisciplinary means using the various disciplines in combination while pinpointing to contradictions or gaps, if existing, while asking why. Sometimes I think that quite often we forget to ask questions. We just take the things as they are, and this is a very dangerous approach. So asking why, it's a very important step. Was it intentional? What should be the approach to deal with such situation, etc.? Now I'm doing this. I'm going here. Um, other things for terminology, archaeology, the study of the old, and not only for excavated or underground stuff. And therefore, beyond excavation, it therefore includes art and architecture of historic periods. This is my view, and of course, it can be argued against. There is a great difference between archaeologists and art historians and architects on the one hand, and on the other, the historians in interpreting a history, situation, or a situation that quite often than not involves tension, even also hostility, that ends in work in isolation. Historians, they start pointing... for archaeologists and art historians, as I see it and my experience tells, they visualize the data or solid data as a starting point of interpreting history. And they accuse historians that in case of contradiction, and the historians accuse the archaeologists or the art historians in case there are contradictions, that they ignore the contradictions, they eliminate the data, and consequently also the material evidence is treated very bad, and there is a malinterpretation of history in general. Historians, on the other hand, use the written documents, and they see the written documents as the starting point for analyze history. And they accuse archaeologists and art historians, as I said before, for too much technological use and detail and using observation of petty details. Now, there are two prominent problems. A, use of art architecture and archaeology for only illustration. This is another... this is an accusation of archaeologists or art historians against historians, and I accept it. Many of us use illustrative evidence only for illustration. B, in case of contradiction and gaps, we historians ignore the art or archaeological finds. Now, there is some problems with the historians' attitudes, and therefore I'm asking, are the historians always right? The expertise field, the answer is absolutely not. The expertise field of study of the historians is a starting point to analyze historic events. And I would like to illustrate this. Still recently, for example, the Economic School of the Sorbonne produced the main perspective of the foundation of Venice's Statue de Mar. As a result, this school forced an economic reality that never existed or related a later improved economic situations made during Venetian rule to explain aerial Venetian motives. In other words, this school claims that the Venice intentionally diverted the Fourth Crusade in order to acquire the Byzantine islands and the parts in Greece because they were very fertile, they were rich, in order to exploit the revenues for Venice's own use. But in fact, many of the conquered islands were very poor, and some of them were only developed during Venetian rule. So this is a very distorted perspective, and when it doesn't work with the economist historians, you can tell when reading their various articles how they try to manipulate, and it's quite confusing and very not well treated. Another thing, a another fault of the historians is the limitations of paleographic skills. Many of the historians can't read earlier documents of the 13th, 14th centuries, and therefore they use the 16th century documents to interpret the events and of the earlier periods. This creates a distortion of the earlier periods, because many times the historians of the 16th century facing a new reality for Venice. Venice has to acknowledge the existence of another maritime empire, the Ottomans, in order to save face for Venice because of psychological motives, to lift the spirits. They misinterpreted the past events and give Venice a glorious history after the Fourth Crusade. In other words, Venice created its maritime empire already after the Fourth Crusade, but when we read carefully the various types of the historic documents, we can tell that in fact the Venetian maritime empire began evolving only from the late 14th century, and the main motive was defensive. This is one point. The second point is that in order to build an empire, lots of money has to be invested, lots of manpower. Venice lacked such resources in much of its period. Such interpretation, according to such interpretation, there is I wonder about a restoration. One of the pictures included in the restoration committed in 1578 in the room of the Great Council at the Palazzo Ducale after the Great Fire in 1577, depicting the Fourth Crusade and the meeting of the Pope and the German Emperor at Venice in 1177. Was it accidental, especially after the Battle of Lepanto and the so-called totally Venice victory, but Venice wouldn't have won very much the battle if it didn't enjoy help from other powers. But still, I'm very, I'm using also the, in very shallow sense, the art thing here. Now, there is another problem of historians and art historians or architecture while using the later period in order to analyze earlier periods. For example, by using the not authentic documents. And I have a very beautiful example of the Castello d'Amau of Methoni. When I'm talking about Methoni, Methoni is this is the red. Okay, Methoni is this is the point. Okay, I'm talking about this place. Okay, I'm talking about this place and the island of Sapienza. If I'm looking at the satellite. Methoni. The port of Methoni was, I'm going to relate to the terminology of a port. The port of Methoni, or Methoni was conquered, was required by Enrico Dandolo in the partition agreement of the Byzantine Empire right at the eve of the conquest of Constantinopolis. In 1204, because its location at the southeast of the Peloponnese, and the Venetians in fact built there the pots only at the second half of the 14th century. And what they did more, they built what we can see here, the Castello da Mar, the maritime castle, where there are two big articles written about analyzing the architecture of the Castello da Mar, and it was analyzed as an typical Ottoman castle because of its shape. It's quasi round. However, when I checked the documents the scholar used, he used the documents of the 16th century, and I have documents of 1358. At that period, the Venetians initiated and did the Castello da Mar because its shape, it gives a very round perspective view of the entrance into the port of Modon. And this was the intention to build it in this shape. And this was one of the way to teach me that we can't analyze from the shape of a building or monument the type of architecture. In other words, we can't say because the Ottomans built in round towers, this is an Ottoman tower. I had a very funny incident, and the scholar who provided the architecture, the documents, is from my own country, Professor Ben Yarbel, and he's dealing only with the 16th century. And this architecture, he told me the story because I talked about this incident, and he told me that the other scholar asked him to look at the archives. As he's dealing with the 16th century, he gave him the documents of the 16th century. They don't talk about the building, but talk about the existing monument. And that architecture analyzed and made the old theory about the architecture of Ottoman towers in Greece. So this is a very typical situation when we use later documents in order to interpret an earlier period. Now, dealing with port towns and ports, in interdisciplinary system, I'll take this port as an example. And I'll finish with this. What disciplines, what question I'm going to use? Just a moment. First of all, what is the definition of a port? Because in Latin we have the term portus, and we have to ask if port is an artificial port or a natural port, only a harbor. And there is a great difference between the two because of several motives. First, the natural harbor doesn't cost a penny, and to build ports, we need a lot of financial resources and also skills. And the question is whether the engineering skills to build ports, and this is a large view, analyzing each port and then comparing to Venice itself. One of the things I'm doing today is the ramifications of the human involvement in Venice Lagoon in order to explain the situation Venice experienced today. And the picture is very interesting. Although Venice is a maritime entity, it didn't require any, it didn't possess any marine engineering skills, marine engineers to build in Venice and to build outside Venice and to maintain the ports. So this is very interesting, talking about the intellectual and skills of the medieval period. Another thing is, which I started to understand it, that Venice refused to invest in building artificial ports because it costs money. And from Venice experience, ports didn't make, if the Venetians had used natural ports before, why to invest in artificial ports. And this reflects on Venice policy towards its colonies or territories of the Stato d'Amar. Eventually, Venice had to build ports because the Venetians in the Stato d'Amar threatened to leave those territories because the ports was perceived as a front protection for the port town itself, not for the ships, as for the port town itself. So this is another interesting point, and the more and against any enemy and pirates. So this is very important, and when you have this protection, you can manage thriving economical and commercial life. So this is a different perspective how we see ports. So if we look at the port of Modone, this is the one. What we see here is the medieval town of Methoni. This is the Castello d'Amar, and the mole was here. Okay, I'm shaking. I'm sorry. See, it's here. And we can see it here underwater. And this is the Ottoman. This is the modern main mole. But the medieval mole of Methoni is still underwater. It was excavated by an archaeologist whose skills are the Roman period. So he analyzed the remains as they were constructed during the Roman period. And he didn't consult any of the documents, and the Venetian archives are full of the documents, the technological skills involved in this construction, which give us, as I said before, some picture about problems and marine engineering problems of the period. One thing I'm very much interested in, and I'm very much frustrated, and I would like to end my paper with this, is about the Dalmatian coast, about the were there artificial ports, were there efforts to build artificial ports, was it necessary to build the artificial ports, or were there only natural ports, and what did was the relation between the port town and the sea. Thank you.
I think we will have a discussion about this problem of Dalmatian ports, probably. Our next speaker is Dr. Donald Cooper. Dakle, naš sljedeći gost je Dr. Donald Cooper. Predaje na sveučilištu u Cambridge, tamo je znači djelatnik Jesus College-a. Predaje znači renesansnu umjetnost. Inače, dosta je, pogotovo u zadnje vrijeme, usmjeren na hrvatsku srednjovjekovnu povijest, pogotovo od 2000. negdje i 3. godine, istražuje znači dominikanske i franjevačke samostane i umjetničku baštinu tih dominikanskih franjevačkih samostana uz našu obalu. Tako je i napisao znači i prilog tome u knjizi Croatia, Aspects of Art, Architecture and Cultural Heritage. Autor je također zajedno sa Janet Robson i knjige The Making of Assisi, The Pope, The Franciscans and The Painting of the Basilica. U recentno vrijeme također istražuje znači i u arhivima diljem znači hrvatske obale, poglavito u Dubrovačkom arhivu. Pa dakle, danas ćemo čuti izlaganje Pilgrim Accounts as Sources for Ecclesiastical Art in 15th Century Dubrovnik. Znači, putopisi, hodočasnički putopisi kao vrela za crkvenu povijest 15. stoljetnog Dubrovnika.
Thank you. and thank you to the Croatian Historical Institute and more particularly to the conference organizers, Drs. Irena Benjovski-Latin and Zrinka Pejorda-Vardic, for the invitation and the opportunity to present in this conference amidst such splendid surroundings today. This talk was is based on archival research that I did in Dubrovnik a couple of years ago, and as I prepared this paper, I also received very generous assistance from Dr. Anna Marinkovic of the Art Historical Institute in Zagreb, and also Dr. Marijana Kovacevic of the University of Zadar. I should add that all errors and mistakes are very much my own. Okay, this paper takes as its starting point the rich corpus of pilgrims' accounts from the 15th century that describe Dubrovnik. Pilgrims, whether German, French, or Italian, were invariably impressed by Renaissance Ragusa and provide us with important descriptions of the city's major monuments. My focus is on how they respond to the city's major churches, the cathedral, and also the two main mendicant convents belonging to the Dominicans and Franciscans. These buildings were, as we all know, either totally destroyed or gravely damaged in the 1667 earthquake, making these glimpses of their Renaissance appearance all the more precious. Nonetheless, these sources have not been unproblematic for art historians, and it is difficult to link surviving artworks with these historical descriptions. And here I would like to suggest, in the spirit of this conference, that these narrative sources can, in fact, revise our understanding of two of the most important works associated with the city's leading painter of the mid-15th century, Lovro Dobrijevic, native of Kotor. And this is very much work in progress, and I approach Dubrovnik a little like our pilgrims, as an outsider, unable to spend as much time there as I would like. I'm also aware of the wealth of expertise on Dubrovnik and its history gathered in the audience this morning, and I look forward very much to your comments and doubtless a few corrections as well. Now, what I want to focus in on when considering these pilgrim accounts is a group of silver altarpieces that are described by many of the pilgrims who visit Dubrovnik over the high altars of the city's principal churches, and in particular over the high altars of the cathedral, of the Dominican and Franciscan monasteries. There's also, of course, another example, which is in the church of St. Blaise, which I won't talk about today for due to time. I start off with Dubrovnik Cathedral, and what must have been an extremely impressive silver readable over the high altar of the cathedral, which is described in a number of pilgrims' accounts, and I put a selection of them there. Very likely, this had two registers of figures, or either 12 figures in total, or more likely 18, and it was placed above the high altar and below a marble ciborium. And we can compare that with descriptions of the silver altarpiece that was in the Franciscan convent in the city, the convent of Mali Brač, which was commissioned at the close of the 14th century, and we have some good documentation for that. And in particular, the Milanese canon, Pietro Cazzola, provides an extremely detailed description of this work, recording two registers of 12 figures each, and he marveled at the number of precious stones. He actually was a little disturbed that they weren't more securely guarded, he was surprised that, in fact, members of the laity hadn't tried to prise them off the readable. The third silver altarpiece was in the Dominican church. Relatively fewer pilgrims describe this because fewer of them make it to the Dominican Church. The Franciscan Church seems to have been a more popular destination for our groups of pilgrims. And it was being completed when Philip de Diversis was writing his encomium of the city of Dubrovnik in 1440. Fortunately, Padre Serafino Razzi provides us with a very detailed description of the Ritable, including its saints, as it still existed in the late 16th century. Now, none of these works survive, and to gain an impression of their original appearance, we probably have to move up the Adriatic coast to Kirk Cathedral, where we still have a very large two-tiered silver Ritable over the high altar of the town's cathedral. And I think it's worth noting at this point that the existence of these kinds of silver altarpieces in mendicant churches is, to my knowledge, really completely exceptional in a European context. I don't know of any examples in Italy, in Franciscan or Dominican churches or elsewhere, and this may have been one of the reasons why these objects struck visiting pilgrims as remarkable and worthy of comment. And we might also think about the silver altarpiece which still survives over the high altar of Kotor Cathedral by the Swiss goldsmith John of Basel. And we know, of course, that he's active also in Dubrovnik and would have known the city's silver altarpieces. Now, at this point, we'll switch focus slightly to consider Dobrichevich, and how the evidence of these pilgrim accounts and related sources intersects with the study and reconstruction of two major painted altarpieces, which have a central place in our understanding of painting in 15th century Dubrovnik. And the first is an altarpiece that is now divided between the Ranger's House in Greenwich in southeast London, the so-called Ludlow Annunciation, and the Standing Saints in now in Prague in the Narodny Gallery. And these were first put together, first reconstructed as a single polyptych by the Italian art historian Federico Zeri in 1971. I don't think anyone's really disputed that they belong together. Now, the Ludlow Annunciation, of course, we can now appreciate in the UK, and I show you here a couple of details to remind you of this painting's really exceptional quality, and we hope that it should be cleaned in the not-too-distant future. And also to point out the clear debts that are apparent in Dobrichevich's work, not only to Venetian painting, but also really to very up-to-date developments in 15th century Florence. I'll show you there a comparison of the vase in the Ludlow Annunciation with work by Filippo Lippi, which can't have been really that much earlier. And one would love to know more about Dobrichevich's sources for the mysterious figure atop the column beside the Virgin's House, and I show you a couple of speculative but nonetheless suggestive comparisons. Now, the altarpiece's iconography is overwhelmingly Franciscan, with four of six saints on the main register from the order, and Saint Jerome, so important to Franciscan identity in Dalmatia, really standing in as an honorary fifth. The sixth, as many of you will know on this side, Saint Nicholas, is actually extraneous to the rest of the altarpiece. It's an unrelated panel attributed to the shop of the Vivarini, and it was probably inserted into this ensemble in the 19th century to replace a missing or damaged figure. In this light, it's tempting to connect this polyptych with the Male Brach Church in Dubrovnik, famed for its art and its decoration in the pilgrim accounts I reviewed at the start of this paper. And several art historians, amongst them Miklos Boskovits, Gregor Gamelin, and more recently Milan Pelch, have made a connection between a contract that Dobrichevich signed in 1455 to paint an altarpiece for the Franciscan Church, a commission he completed in 1458. Now, while that's tempting, There are some problems with situating the Greenwich Prague Polyptych within the Malibrach Church. First of all, there really are good reasons for believing that the polyptych was a high altarpiece. The choice of saints would suit a high altar, and the altarpiece is also a seven-field heptaptych, whereas most side altarpieces would be five-field pentaptychs. Okay, so it's too big, too grand, arguably, to be over a side altar. And the 1455 contract was agreed between the artist and a layman, rather than the friars or their lay procurators, which suggests that it was indeed for a private altar. And most fundamentally, implying that the Greenwich Prague Polyptych was over the high altar of the Malibrach Church, ignores the existence of the silver retable that was so praised by the pilgrims who visited the church. And probably, in fact, that 1455 document refers to a commission for one of the chapels in the chapter house. We may need to look elsewhere beyond Dubrovnik for this polyptych's original home. Now, contemporaneously and independently, in two essays published in 2009, myself and Ivana Prijatel-Pavicic drew attention to the presence of Saint Elizabeth, mother of John the Baptist, in the upper tier of the altarpiece. I'll show you there a detail of her, a figure who had previously been misidentified as Saint Catherine of Siena. Now, Saint Elizabeth is a very unusual inclusion for a Franciscan altarpiece, and both myself and Ivana Prijatel made the connection with the Franciscan convent at Rozat at Rijeka Dobrovačka, which was dedicated to the Visitation, in which, of course, St. Elizabeth is the key protagonist after the Virgin herself. And just as St. Elizabeth is an unusual dedication for a Franciscan convent, so it's an unusual inclusion in the polyptych. And the two seem to go together. Now, sorry, this has turned out rather small. I hope that's legible for the eagle-eyed amongst you. In addition to the link with the dedication of the Rozat Church, Ivana Prijatel-Pavicic drew attention to a contract of 1469 by which Dobrijevic promised to paint a polyptych for the Church of St. Mary in Rozat, which would provide a useful date in Dobrijevic's chronology. So again, this seems to confirm that connection. But I think there may be some problems with that document because it looks quite odd for a Franciscan commission. Primarily, we would expect there to be procurators, we would expect there to be mention of the friars, perhaps the guardian of a convent, very much like we have with an earlier commission for that church from the painter Mateo Junjic, where the procurators, in fact, are responsible for the commission. Instead, this first document is, in fact, agreed, this contract is agreed with a chaplain, a priest, a certain Don Bernardo. And this, again, looks rather strange for a Franciscan commission. And, in fact, we can find this Don Bernardus elsewhere in the Dubrovnik archives, and it's clear that he's a parish secular priest. He's not a friar. And how do we explain this? Well, as you can see, he's parish priest in Trestino before he then moves to Ombla, to the church at Rozat. And this is the answer, of course. He's actually parish priest in the Church of St. Mary, which overlooks the Franciscan convent of the Visitation. So this is, in fact, another project, another commission by Dobrijevic. It doesn't look like that 1469 document is for the Franciscan church. So we can probably discount that link and we lose the peg of 1469 for the Greenwich Prague polyptych. It's still possible, of course, that the altarpiece was commissioned for the Franciscans at Rozat. The link between St. Elizabeth and the Visitation is still valid, but not necessarily in that year. And that said, we may expect, or may have expected, St. Elizabeth to be more prominent within the overall composition of the altarpiece if she related to the main dedication of the church. So we might consider another possibility, that the polyptych came from one of the sister churches of the Rozhat convent, which together formed a group of Franciscan foundations belonging to the Vicariate of Bosnia. And this is the Church of St. Jerome at Slano. And that may reflect the very prominent position of St. Jerome within the altarpiece, who's positioned first on the Virgin's right-hand side. And we know, conveniently, from a surviving contract, that in fact Dobrichevich did paint a high altarpiece for this church, except he painted it a few years earlier in 1461. So this is probably about as far as we can go with the Greenwich-Prague polyptych for the moment. I want now to turn to a second altarpiece by Dobrichevich, which is still in Dubrovnik, the baptism polyptych, which is now in the Dominican Convent Museum. And this has always been related since the document was first published by Jurjo Tadic in 1951. It's always been related to a document of 1448, which was a contract between Dobrichevich and Mateo Junjic to paint a panel for the high altar of the Dominican Church. And so this is conventionally understood as a high altarpiece for the Dominican Church in Dubrovnik, and that's, I think, been accepted by most people since then, up to the recent Dominican exhibition at the Klovich Gallery. And this has been very important for analysing Dobrichevich's early style, and also it's provoked considerable debate about the relative contributions between the two painters who are noted in the contract. So whether they are responsible for different sections of the altarpiece, or perhaps Junjic is responsible for the frame. So here we are in the Dominican Church. And none of these discussions, generally these discussions don't refer to the silver high altarpiece, which is described in the pilgrim accounts and other sources. In fact, the earliest sources place the baptism in the sacristy of the Dominican church. Here we have Kovac, I think, is one of the first sources in 1917 recording this altarpiece, not over the high altar, but in the sacristy of the Dominican church. And here we have the sacristy area. I've not been able to ascertain the dedication of the sacristy and its altar. Perhaps there may be others today who have further information or further documents on that, but it does seem to have been rebuilt in the late 15th century. Little inscription there recording the rebuilding of 1485. So can we understand the baptism altarpiece as a high altarpiece for the Dominican church? Well, there are problems for this, because the 1448 commission, I would suggest, refers not to an independent altarpiece, but to a cover, a painted cover, a ferial protective cover for the silver altarpiece. And this, I think, is made clear by an earlier document from 1444, also published by Tadic, which is commissioning the carpentry for this pala feriale, as it were, which was to be designed to open and close. And then later we have, conveniently, thanks to Padre Razzi, a detailed description of this protective painted cover. And he says that it has the same number of figures as the silver altarpiece, that is, two registers of nine figures. Now, this creates multiple problems with identifying the baptism with the 1448 commission. There's no indication, as far as I'm aware, that this structure was intended to function as an opening door structure. The number of saints and registers does not correspond with the descriptions of the silver altarpieces. And also, when one starts to cast a skeptical view over this altarpiece, other problems come to mind. For instance, the iconography of the baptism of Christ, which would be very unusual, exceptional really, for the high altar of a church dedicated to St. Dominic, especially given that the Dominicans usually conventionally have Marian imagery at the center of their high altarpieces. Now, we do have two Dominican saints on the upper register, but they're balanced also by St. Francis, and really the emphasis in the main register is on the principal state saints of the city, Blaise, Nicholas, Michael, and Stephen. And this is further emphasized by the two supplicants who kneel to either side of Blaise and Nicholas. And these are laymen, they don't seem to be Dominicans. Now, it's difficult to know what the Dominican shutters would have looked like. We know that both the cathedral and Franciscan silver high altarpieces were also equipped with ferrule doors. The only example that we now have is the early 16th century reliquary cupboard, which is in the sacristy of Marly Brach. But that gives you some idea of the local taste for these structures. Now, the iconography of the baptism should really go over an altar dedicated to St. John the Baptist. This is the case for all examples where baptisms form the central field of polyptics. One thinks of Piero della Francesca at San Sepolcro, Giovanni Bellini in Vicenza. Could this have been a side altar in a Dominican church dedicated to the Baptist, perhaps even the sacristy? Perhaps. But we do, and I should say, we don't have a comprehensive list of altar dedications in the Dominican church. Like the Franciscans, the Dominicans were exempt from the 1574 apostolic visitation. John the Baptist does not appear amongst the altars we do know of from notarial documentation and Serafino Razzi's description, although there may be more to be discovered. I'm thinking in particular of Anna Marinkovic's recent work on the altar dedicated to the Hungarian saints in the Dominican chapter house, with a rich cache of documents published alongside. Given all of this, should we be open to the possibility that the baptism was not painted for the Dominican church at all? An obvious context would be the cathedral baptistry. As De Versus tells us, the only baptismal font in the city was at the baptistry. One of our pilgrims, Pierre Barbatre, mentioned a baptism at the cathedral. For the pre-Baroque cathedral, we are largely dependent on the excavations from the 1980s, and by the 15th century, it seems that the baptistry was an independent structure to the rest of the old cathedral facade. This structure survived the 1667 earthquake and was only demolished in the early 19th century. According to the description of the 1574 visitation, it had a polyptic inside, described in the same terms as Dobrychevich's altarpiece in the Danche Monastery. And further research on the post-1667 documents in the Archbishop's archive may confirm or disprove this hypothesis, but it's tempting to think that the altarpiece may have made its way to the Dominican church as late as the 19th century, following the demolition of the medieval baptistry. So to conclude, where does this brief appraisal leave us? Most of all, it teaches us that the artistic appetite of pilgrims was very different to that of 20th century art historians. The silver readables impressed them as part of a larger experience of ecclesiastical metalwork and reliquaries. Paintings hardly figure in their accounts. Their experience of the city was also invariably narrow, encompassing the urban core and its principal shrines. No one, of course, made it to Rozat. Art historians have perhaps been too ready to accept this privileged topography, overlooking the city's wider hinterland. At the same time, the desire to associate the few surviving fragments of Renaissance painting in Dubrovnik with the city's key churches has sometimes overlooked the evidence of pilgrim accounts as well as the local archives. A careful rereading of the published sources, not to mention the many that still lie in the archives, allows us to recover to some degree the riches that our pilgrims encountered over the altars of Dubrovnik's churches, and also to arrive at a new understanding of the relative place of the city's greatest painter of the mid-15th century, Lovro Dobrychevich, in Dubrovnik's wider artistic production. Thank you.
I nakon što smo započeli s pričom o narativnim vrelima kroz jedan ovako maritimno-povijesno-arheološki kontekst, pa zatim kroz povjesničarskog umjetnički kontekst i vjerujem da će naši povjesničari umjetnosti ovdje imati sigurno tema za diskusiju. Dolazimo znači do kronika koje će vjerojatno ova dva dana biti zapravo dobrim dijelom najviše u središtu, znači priče, naracije. Dolazimo znači do profesora Mladena Ančića, pretpostavljam da ga ne trebam previše predstavljati, znači sveučilišni profesor na sveučilištu u Zagrebu, na Hrvatskim studijima, sveučilištu u Zadru i sveučilištu u Mostaru, autor brojnih zapaženih monografija i studija. I on će nam znači danas reći nešto o kronikama kao izvoru o historiografiji.
Štovane dame i gospodo, dobar dan. Hvala organizatoricama na pozivu, hvala na upornosti koja uspijeva održati ovu izvrsnu tribinu. I ja ću se odmah fokusirati na ovo što imam reći, da bi to nekako priveli kraju u predviđenom roku. Srednjovjekovna kronika u različitim varijantama podrijetlo vuče iz literarnih prototipova antičke latinske literature i predstavlja temeljnu formu prenošenja spoznaja i znanja o prošlosti u tome svijetu. U pojednostavljenoj definiciji, da parafraziram Johna Kenneta Hyde-a, ona je usmjerena na to da zabilježi što je točnije moguće, Božja i dijela velikih ljudi organizirana poglavito kroz kronološko izlaganje. No, u vrijeme stvaranja i oblikovanja moderne akademske historiografije u prvoj polovici 19. stoljeća, kronike i opće narativna vrela gurnuta su u drugi plan zanimanja nove generacije profesionalnih povjesničara. Vjera u točnost, preciznost i objektivnost službenog dokumenta kao vjernoga zrcala stvarnosti što ga proizvodi profesionalna i nezainteresirana državna birokracija, učinila je od kronike drugorazredno vrelo. Kronika, odnosno narativni tekst uopće, proglašena je subjektivnom slikom svijeta, te je svaku tvrdnju koju je htio preuzeti iz takvoga teksta povjesničar bio dužan koroborirati drugim vrelom. Tek se tijekom 20. stoljeća kronika postupno vraća u fokus pozornosti modernog povjesničara, no sada ne više u prvom redu kao vrelo pouzdanih podataka o događajima, već kao prozor u misaoni svijet prošlosti preko zrcalne slike uma njezina autora. Srednjovjekovna kronika, međutim, jako nije nastajala u literarnom svijetu koji karakterizira tiskarski stroj i široka društvena difuzija teksta otisnutoga u beskrajnom nizu redaka, nije pri kraju 20. stoljeća ostala netaknuta prodorom novih shvaćanja što su dolazile iz područja kritičke teorije. Nova kritika, lingvistički obrat, poststrukturalizam i konačno postmoderna shvaćanja posljednjih desetljeća 20. stoljeća otvorili su nove vizure i na srednjovjekovne narativne tekstove. S jedne strane sve se jasnije počinju uočavati različiti žanrovi iz njih izvedene tipologije, povijest, historija, kronika, kronikon, anali, anales, dijela, gesta, opisi, deskripcijo, hagiografija, vite, sanktorum, tek su grube žanrovske odrednice nerijetko istaknute već u naslovima koje su sami autori davali svojim tekstovima. Zavirimo li međutim na stranice vodiča kroz vrela srednjovjekovne povijesti Raula van Kanegema, vidjet ćemo kako su se te grube podjele dalje račvale. Kronike su podijeljene na one svjetske s jedne i one nacionalne, regionalne i lokalne s druge strane, na crkvene povijesti, pa onda nacionalne povijesti germanskih naroda i tako dalje i tako dalje. Još složenije podjele podrazumijeva golema serija tipologija vrela srednjovjekovnog zapada, čiji su si autori stavili zadatak, ne samo kako oni kažu, definirati značajke svih tipova srednjovjekovnih vrela, nego čak, pomalo začuđujuće, i utvrditi pravila njihova tumačenja. Suočavanje žanrovskih odrednica sve je veće značenje u raščlambi tekstova dobivala intertekstualnost kao posljedica odsustva zahtjeva za originalnošću i sklonosti srednjovjekovnih autora za slobodnim i ničim ograničenim posezanjem u literarnu tradiciju. Postupno su se počeli uočavati modeli i kanoni literarne tradicije, komparativnom se raščlambom moglo doći do liste srednjovjekovnih topoi, te zapravo pokazati i dokazati da je ta srednjovjekovna literarna tradicija u velikoj mjeri odredila literarnu tradiciju oblikovanu u vremenu obilježenom novom formom prenošenja teksta tiskanom stranicom. Iako se neko vrijeme činilo da žanrovska opredjeljenja i tipologije znatno pomažu u razumijevanju, a onda i susjednoj interpretaciji srednjovjekovnih tekstova, svaki susret sa stvarnim tekstovima ostavljao je malo mjesta dvojbi glede toga da su žanrovi ipak tek uvjetne i vrlo difuzne kategorije. Ne treba puno uvjeravanja i dokazivanja tvrdnji da gotovo svaki tekst, čak i kad je žanrovski definiran već naslovom, a njegov autor ne spada u intelektualnu kremu svoga doba, ima umiješanih sastojaka različitih žanrova. Za primjer ću uzeti tekst koji je nekako ostao po strani interesa hrvatske historiografije, ponajprije stoga što govori o otoku Braču, koji je i sam na dalekome horizontu povjesničarskog pogleda na srednjovjekovnu stvarnost istočne obale Jadrana. Već svojim naslovom Bracije insule descriptio bračkoga nadpopa i kasnijega hvarsko-bračko-viškog biskupa Dujma Krankovića, jasno ukazuje pripadnost žanru koji se na susjednoj talijanskoj obali kao descriptio civitatis razvijao još od 8. stoljeća te dobio posve novu dimenziju s prodorom humanističkih ideja u 14. stoljeću. Ni na istočnoj obali Jadrana ne manjka tekstova toga žanra, iako je brački descriptio, ostavimo li po strani enciklopedijsko dijelo 10. stoljeća De administrando imperio, zapravo najstariji primjer nakon kojega će, ali posve izvjesno bez ugledanja na Krankovića, slična djela napisati Filip de Diverzis, Juraj Šižgorić i Paladin Fusco. Unatoč tomu što je od početka svoj tekst fokusirao kao pravi deskripcijo, Dujan Kranković je tek u prvoj trećini svoga kratkoga uratka ostao vjeran toj početnoj zamisli. Vrlo brzo se prebacio na kroničarski modus izlaganja, upuštajući se u izlaganje povijesti svoga otoka i pozivajući na autoritet pergamena koje je konzultirao te na autoritet svoga prečasnika nadpopa Stojše, koji je, kako veli, pisao o grčkoj kolonizaciji otoka. Čitao je Dujam navodno i stare spise plemenite obitelji Krankovića, ali poslije izvjesno i tomu Arcidžakona i Andriju Dandola, čija povijesna razlaganja slobodno prenosi, ali i prepravlja, a da ih ni ne spomene. Jasno je naravno da Dujan Kranković inspiraciju crpi iz tekstova tipa Descriptio Civitatis. Ali mu, i to je također savršeno jasno, povelik problem predstavlja činjenica da na njegovu otoku nema grada. No i u tome pogledu mu povijest nudi izlaz. Nije teško retorički ostatke gradinskih zidina u selu Škrip pretvoriti u ostatke grada, pa onda čak i napisati kratku povijest toga zamišljenog grada. Hibridna je narav teksta, u ovome slučaju većim dijelom tek privid. Pravi deskripciju, naime, podrazumijeva i povijesni opis. Ali ostaje doista otvoreno pitanje kako primjerice razlučiti kroničarske i hagiografske elemente u tekstu kakav je život svetoga Ivana Trogirskog. Vita Beati Johannis episkopi et confessoris traguriensis et eius miracula. Poglavito u opširnom i podrobnom opisu Kolomanove opsade Zadra. Sve nam to ipak ne bi trebalo odvući pozornost druge važne značajke koju otkriva djelo Dujma Krankovića. Ta je, naime, zaključak da u krajevima na koje je ovdje fokusiran naš pogled, grad igra važnu ulogu u srednjovjekovnim tekstovima, bez obzira na njihovo žanrovsko opredjeljenje. Ulaziti potanje u razglabanje zašto je tomu tako, tražilo bi puno više vremena od onoga što mi ovdje stoji na raspolaganju. Dostatno je naznačiti kako je, zahvaljujući spletu povijesnih okolnosti, jedan specifičan oblik onoga što zovemo grad, naselje razvedenog plana opasano zidom i k tomu sjedište biskupa, upravo u ovim krajevima ostao praktično jedini repozitori pisanih srednjovjekovnih tragova života. U tome je gradu bila relevantna, pa je čuvana, prepisivana i prenošena lokalna tekstualna predaja. Čak i u slučajevima tekstova koji su fokusirani na širi prostor gradskog okruženja, poput primjerice ljetopisa Kraljeva Hrvatske i Dalmacije, odnosno Hrvatske redakcije ljetopisa Popa Dukljana, ili pak onih krajnje jednostavnih pripisa i dodataka kakvi su Kvaliter ili pripisi Montaneju samostana Svetog Petra u selu, odnosno Supetarskom kartularu, oni su sačuvani zahvaljujući tomu što su nastajali u gradu ili su tu naknadno dospjeli. Važno je to pripomenuti jer ti tekstovi otkrivaju jedan vrlo specifičan i ograničen koncept grada. Mentalnu sliku koja je dio kolektivnog mentalnog krajolika koji upravo stanovnika tih naselja i njihova neposrednog okruženja. Vidjeli smo kako su Dujmu Krankoviću ostaci zidova dostatna osnovica za zamišljanje grada. A tu istu sliku zrcali i prve vedute Splita uklopljene kao minijature u glagoljski rukopis Hrvoja Misala, na kojima je grad predstavljen plaštom zida i tek pokojim vrhom objekata koji nadvisuju vizuru toga plašta. No razvedeni plan naselja s plaštom zida ipak nije dostatan da bi naselje postalo civitas. Gotovo stoljeće nakon Dujma Krankovića i anonimnog slikara minijatura Hrvojeva misala, Paladin Fusco opisujući Vranu veli da se tamo nalazi, citiram, vrlo sigurna utvrda s bedemom, opkopom i nasipom u kojoj živi, kako on kaže, približno 300 obitelji. Na svu sreću, na nešto kasnije izrađenoj Paganovoj karti Zadra i njegova zaleđa predstavljena je i Vrana. I to na takav način da savršeno odgovara Fuskovu opisu. No u njegovu je tekstu ipak to naselje označeno kao vikus. Bruna Kuntić-Makvić taj izričaj prevodi riječju selo, što čini mi se ne odgovara duhu teksta, pa bi svakako sretniji prijevod bio varoš. Uz što valja pripomenuti da su Fusku naselja bez plašta zida Obrovac i Bag Skrizija, koja su i na Paganovoj karti predstavljena kao borgo, također vici. Vrlo sličan rezultat svačanja toga što je grad pokazat će raštamba s jedne strane načina na koji je o naseljima na obali i u unutrašnjosti govori sredinom 14. stoljeća anonimni autor teksta poznato kao Obsidio Jadrenzis i s druge strane izjava napuljskih plemića na službi na istočnoj obali Jadrana početkom 15. stoljeća. Anonimni autor opsade samo je na jednome mjestu kao opću imenicu uporabio izričaj civitates Croatie, doćim pojam civitas redovito rabi za oznaku primorskih ili gradova Dalmacije uopće, odnosno Trogira i Nina pojedinačno. No kad govori o Kninu ili Bihaću, onda redovito rabi pojmove fines ili mete, te ih povezuje uz te toponime, odnosno kninsku utvrdu kao i onu ostrovičku, naziva opidum. S druge strane, napoljski plemići u službi pretendenta kralja Ladislava Napoljskog davali su pred Ladislavovim zastupnikom u Zadru 1404. godine izjave o jednom međusobnom fizičkom obračunu i postupku linča nad slugom jednoga od njih, što se sve odigralo za njihova boravka u Bihaću prethodne 1403. godine. U zabilježenim iskazima, sačuvanim u formi javnobilježničke isprave, čiji je sadržaj očito diktirao kraljev zastupnik, Bihać se naziva Tera Bikiđi. Pa se iz te Tere Bikiđi izlazi preko mosta, ili kako tamo stoji, per pontem ipsius Tere Bikiđi. Dok se vojnici ostavljaju in Bikiđio, gdje se nalaze i kuće u kojima su bili smješteni. Dakle, ni kod anonimnog autora opsade, kao ni kod napuljskih vitezova, odnosno njihova uvjetno rečeno glasnog govornika, nema više civitatum kad se jednom napusti istočna Jadranska obala. Kao kontrapunkt tome diskursu može poslužiti onaj zabilježen u formalnim dokumentima što ih izdaju različite kancelarije, od kojih je ovdje možda i najvažnija ona vladarska, u kojoj se njegov osobit oblik kroničarskog diskursa u opširnim arengama prigodom navođenja zasluga obdarenika. U tome se diskursu naselja poput Knina, Bihaća, Zagreba ili Varaždina, pa i mnogo manjih sredina, uredno pojavljuju kao civitates. Doćim se ona naselja koja Fusco naziva vikus, pojavljuju od sredine 14. stoljeća u pravilu s nazivom opidum. Uz to nije zgorega upozoriti kako je svećenik Nikola Senković iz Bihaća, lektor Kninske biskupije i u trenutku sastavljanja dokumenta u kojem se spominje 1401. godine već bivši župnik crkve Svetog Stjepana Kralja u Kninu, naselje u kojem se nalazi njegova bivša crkva jasno naziva civitas, što bez ikakve ograde prihvaća i zadarski javni bilježnik koji po njegovu zahtjevu sastavlja ispravu o odricanju od župničke časti. U dokumentu se izrijekom navode Domini Judices et communitas civitatis tinini. No, vraćajući se na pojam opidum, posuđen inače iz antičke literarne tradicije, a s time ću poantirati, valja primijetiti kako se on pojavljuje u literarnom diskursu izvan onoga mediteranskog kruga u zanimljivome obratu kod Ivana Česmičkoga, koji u jednome od svojih epigrama čak tvrdi kako, citiram, u onome dijelu Panonije, koji Slavonijom zove se sada, ima poviše pagusa, a ni jednoga opiduma. Ovdje je dakle pagus ono što je kod Fuska vikus, a u kraljevskoj kancelariji opidum. Ovaj potonji pojam pak ovdje očito označava ono što se drugdje zove civitas. Štoviše, isti taj Česmički u jednoj od svojih elegija za jajce čak koristi pojam urbs, pokazujući time, bar na prvi pogled, kako su šarolike bile mentalne slike što su tvorile fond društvenog znanja na različitim dijelovima prostora na koji ovdje fokusiramo pozornost. Popuniti sadržajem Ljušturovih pojmova, a što razumijevam kao naš posao i zadaću, znači definirati i ocrtati mentalne slike koje su stajale iza njih i način na koji su ti pojmovi korišteni u različitim narativnim tekstovima, koje tek grubom kategorizacijom možemo svrstati u kroničarski diskurs. To znači da kroz komparativnu raštvambu valja sagledati kakvi sadržaji stoje iza pojma civitas kad ga koristi literarna produkcija nastala u mediteranskom krugu, a što on podrazumijeva kad ga koristi primjerice kraljevska kancelarija. Dakako da pri takvu poslu valja uzeti u obzir i praksu u dnevnoj komunikaciji kroz koju su se pojmovi brusili i ugrađivali u mentalne krajolike i fond društvenog znanja, nekad sukladno, a nekad u kontrapunktu s literarnim tradicijama i modelima što su dolazili iz polja uvjetno rečeno učene kulture. S fokusom na mediteranski kulturni krug, vidljivim iz programa ove konferencije, nadati se da će na njezinome kraju pojam civitas, kako se koristi u literarnoj tradiciji toga kulturnog kruga, biti znatno jasniji. Kao što bi trebalo postati jasno kako je i zašto bila ograničena njegova uporaba na stanoviti broj naselja na istočnoj obali Jadrana. Hvala.
Time smo čuli sva predviđena izlaganja prve današnje sekcije i dakako otvaram diskusiju. Ukoliko imate pitanja, znači, za goste iz inozemstva, možete ih postaviti ili na engleskom ili na hrvatskom, pa ćemo prevesti. I nadam se i vjerujem da imate pitanja, znači, za sva tri izlagača. Znači, evo, otvaram raspravu. Evo, izvolite,
profesor Borislav Grgin. I would like to pose a question to Professor Berkman. It was a very interesting concept about the alternative approach to the question of the Fourth Crusade and the post-Fourth Crusade development. You criticized some of the economic historians, but what I have missed in your paper till now was the alternative explanation of the idea of the creation of the empire after the whole process. So would you please clarify your position?
Okay. So if you'd like to, maybe, yes, to hear it better.
I didn't do it here because this was not the theme of this paper. There is coming paper of mine dealing with this subject. Well, this is complicated because in the partition pact of the Byzantine Empire, the Doge Dandolo acted as a private person. He wasn't authorized by Venice itself, and for the partition pact. And when you look at the sites he chose, none of them was fertile, except of Cephalonia and in the Ionian, but neither Corfu, not even after the Venetian occupation, neither Methone. Methone was supported during the Venetian occupation by Corone and also Crete later. He didn't ask for Negroponte, he asked only for Castor in the south. So, and Salamis in New Athens, and when you analyze what was missing in the Sorbonne school was the maritime space, and we are talking about maritime space if we want it or not, because also when we say Stato da Mare, it's the mare. And so the school of Sorbonne, which analyzed only the economic perspective, because I'm doing also the economic, missed all the maritime space. And Dandolo, what he did, his concept was of a commercial, of a merchant, Venetian merchant, going towards Constantinopolis and the Black Sea. The other islands in the Aegean were of the Latin kingdom of the former Byzantine Empire at Constantinopolis. However, the Crusaders did not own a fleet, didn't own any ships, and they asked for the help of Venetians. And the Venetians who helped the Byzantine, the Latin Emperor of Constantinopolis, were those merchant people who had to renounce their commerce during the Fourth Crusade, and they found the opportunity here to compensate for the losses they had suffered. And one of the prominent ones is the Sanudo. He conquered the central Kyklades. His orientation was towards the Levant. Via the central Kyklades went the very important marine route from Venice, the western Mediterranean, towards the Levant. He exercised also, although it's a hush-hush to say, also piracy. So, and they were either independent, and never, no chronicle of the 13th century identified Sanudo as the Dukes of Naxos. The Dukes of Naxos, a terminology, was only so-called invented at the end of the 14th, but mainly the 16th century. So, when you unfold the events from the beginning towards later periods, you see another history from when you analyze it from only two dimensions, I mean the economic and the, or from the 16th century. In any event, I'm dealing with the long Due. Venice also, after Dandolo's death, Venice itself didn't have the resources to acquire all the possessions he asked. And the interesting point is, for Corfu, Venice gave the island for a couple of noble Venetians. They didn't manage to hold the island, and they lost it against the Byzantine. Venice didn't have any identified policy towards this acquisition. Crete, for example, Dandolo bought during the Fourth Crusade, in order not to let it fall to the hands of the Genoese. The story is the one of the Genoese. Montferrat offered the Genoese the island. The island was very marginal, so the Genoese weren't interested, so Dandolo said, I'm going to acquire it, not to let the Genoese to have the island. But Venice never implement its acquisition, only from the beginning from the 30s of the 13th century, and it costed a lot of money. I mean, the first immigration was in 1211, but then Venice was indebted to her merchants because the government didn't have any money to invest in this acquisition. But a different policy, you can tell from the second half, and mainly from the 80s of the 14th century, when you can see a policy, intentional policy of acquiring places where Venice was ready to invest efforts and resources. So, and the reason was because Venice was in a very difficult situation, first against the Genoese, it was for defensive motives. So, I can give you some, I have different papers dealing with this subject because it's a lecture by itself, but some idea I hope I gave.
Okay. Thank you. Dakle, druga pitanja, ako imamo, slobodno, dr. Zoran Ladić sa Hrvatske akademije za znanosti. Zorane, hoćeš možda bliže doći da te bolje čujemo?
So I'm dealing also with pilgrim accounts, and therefore I'm interested in this. I'm interested, you mentioned here many notary records from the Dubrovnik archive, and regarding Lovre Dobričević, but I didn't notice any mentioning of pilgrim accounts from the sources. You didn't mention any pilgrim source in which these paintings or altars, altar palace, and so on. You didn't mention these documents, and how punctual are these documents in their description? I mean, these pilgrims who wrote these accounts, how punctual are they? Why they choose to visit just these churches and to visit these places in Dubrovnik? What was the reason? Is there any reliquaries there or something like this? Okay.
Thank you for the question. I should say that none of the pilgrim accounts, really, you get very almost no reference to panel paintings in Nisa. It's not, in a sense, what these pilgrims are interested in. I mean, you have a lot of discussion of reliquaries, and in a sense, these great silver readables sort of fit into that broader experience of precious liturgical metalwork. So you don't have any descriptions of any altarpieces by Dobrijevich. I think that's quite important to emphasize. Now, to what extent are they reliable? Well, there are internal issues with the texts. I mean, it's known that some pilgrim accounts are, in a sense, sourced from other pilgrim accounts. They're not the sort of necessarily unproblematic eyewitness testimonials that we might perhaps was once thought. That said, one can, I think, derive a certain number of correspondences between them and other sources, particularly the rather rich notarial archives, which, you know, we do have the wonderful compendium of documents by Tadic and other publications more recently, and also other sources, like for the Dominicans, for Serafino Razzi, which is a valuable source for the high altarpiece, and there are other ones as well. So I think, I mean, what I would argue is that, in a sense, the tendency amongst art historians to think that the baptism altarpiece, because of, I think, probably a misreading of this 1448 document, was the high altarpiece of the Dominican Church. Yes, it's a very impressive polyptych, but actually there were lots of these. I mean, we know this even from the 1574 visitation. There are dozens of these altarpieces. It's just that these are the three or four that we've got left. So I think I myself, it could be that there are documents there which make a connection between the a Baptist dedication and the high altar, or another altar in the church. But in the absence of that, I think we should be more open to other possibilities, if that makes sense.
Okay.
Do I understand you well that, for instance, you would be interpreting Pietro Arseolo's conquest of Dalmatian towns also for defense purposes, because that's what you said, I think, that their intention was primarily to create defense posts.
Well, yeah, the Dalmatian, there was a problem of some piracy along this route, and the Dalmatian route was obligatory maritime route. But Venice couldn't implement very well its conquest, and one of the things in 1202 that they asked the Crusades, also against the will of the Pope, to reconquer and to suppress. The fact that there were mutinies means that Venice could not implement its dominion. And yes, it was intentional in order to eliminate piracy or to eliminate any obstacle along the way. And it's the same thing with, for example, Corfu, but mainly Methoni. In Methoni, there were many pirates. And in the same way, Venice wanted that particular place. And in, when you see the implementation after the Fourth Crusade, when Venice began, it was 2 years after Dandolo's death. In all those places were pirates, because the pirates settled in a very in very crucified places that were along the sea routes. So holding these places was, many times you do such acts in order to defend yourself, to defend your commerce. It doesn't look logical in modern times, but on that, because you have to understand, there were no permanent fleets. Even when Venice was the only sea power that had a permanent fleet since the early 14th century, but you couldn't hold ships on the sea all the time. It's not like aircraft air carriers like nowadays, or ships like nowadays. So the galleys, you couldn't hold on ships. They are very shallow ships. You had to coast them, to put them on coast. So in order to defend yourself, you have to defend the crucial points along the sea routes.
Uzeli vremena od predviđene pauze, ali to ćemo nadoknaditi, tako da, znači, druga sekcija započinje u 11.45, znači, pola sata vremena za kavu i osvježenje, znači, u 11.45 se vidimo ponovo. Hvala najljepša.
Oh, yeah.